Welcome everybody to another episode of Paradigm Shift and Educational Comedy. Just to clear one thing up real quick, the title that is entitled Tai Lopez and Being the Change, I don't want that to seem misleading because I'm not trying to imply that Tai Lopez is going to be here talking with us, because he's totally not at all. Tai Lopez and Being the Change is the subject of the discussion that me and Richard Hamilton are going to be discussing, and I'm going to do a screen share. Start screen share. Da da da. Okay. Are you able to see his YouTube channel there?
Yes.
Okay, cool. Now, from what I'm able to see so far, just like, I'm going to give you all like my impression of this guy, like what he seems to be to me. So I'm not like making any claims in any particular direction. I'm just kind of giving my observation. Because I was just kind of drawn to this one video that, you know, he's got off his website. I don't know if he has a copy of it on YouTube. It was a video in an embedded player on one of his web links, and I was able to download it using video download helper, but I'm not sure if this is one of the ones he has on his channel or not. It's really long, and I synchronistically align with that. And what he's doing is really interesting, because he's one of those people that went kind of like from rags to riches, but not through, you know, any self-help courses or any, like, 10-step, you know, whatever the hell, you know, all these different things you see everywhere. Oh, get wealth now. He didn't do any of that shit. You know, nothing like that. It was just kind of through synchronicity and circumstance, you know. He was in a particular circumstance where, you know, he was just, you know, poor and crashing on a couch and had, like, 47 bucks to his name or something, and synchronicity just kind of started putting him into all these different directions where he, you know, was meeting people and getting to know people and just kind of, you know, learning from them and worked his way up from there. And through his life journey, you might say, of getting from where he was to where he is, which now is extremely wealthy, there's just a lot of stuff that he learned that would be really, you know, empowering to the masses, but he also understood that, you know, because he's all about paradigms, and he understands that the way society has people programmed, that, like, you know, the old paradigm of thought is like, oh, well, if you know, you're charging money for something, then it has value. But if it's for free, it's worthless, and people tend to not be interested, and blah, blah, blah. Thankfully, that paradigm is slowly shifting, because obviously no one charges you to watch broadcast TV or listen to AM and FM radio. No one charges you to use Google. No one charges you to watch YouTube videos. No one charges you to use Facebook. You know, the world is kind of getting more and more used to the idea of, you know, free on-demand sort of content. So, like, the paradigm that, oh, well, you have to pay a lot of money for something, otherwise, you know, it's not worth dealing with. And that's slowly starting to go out the window. But seeing as he still kind of has one foot caught in each paradigm, as far as I could tell, there's still a lot of old paradigm stuff he is, you know, kind of clinging to, and a part of it is that idea of, oh, well, if you don't have a product to sell somebody, you know, then they're not going to take it seriously. So from that standpoint, what he's done is kind of really brilliant. As far as I could tell, it's not like he sells a course or a package or whatever. He's got a website, and you can pay for membership. I'm not sure if it's like one time ever, once a year, or what it is. And that gives you access to, you know, this web interface that's got all these different types of tools and stuff that, you know, that he personally uses. So to me, that's like the equivalent of, like, you know, how on Wolf Spirit Radio. You know, all the newer show episodes and whatever are free, but then to go like into the archive where you can download unlimitedly, you know, all these different radio shows and stuff that have, you know, been on for a few years now. And there's this whole collection, you know, it's something like the equivalent of like $5 or €5 or whatever it is in a month to have, you know, access to that database, that archive. So it just kind of seems to me like he's, you know, he's doing something similar to that. It's an archive of information, and he's presenting that in the form of, you know, this product access, so to speak, that you can, you know, pay money to get into. And that not only satisfies a, you know, a particular paradigm, but it seems that what he's also looking to do is, like, he's really trying to form a community of like-minded people, that it really is less about money and more about paradigm shifting, so that as this group resonates with each other, gets to know each other, and grows in their paradigm shifting and also their wealth at the same time, that these sovereign people can then, you know, be capable of working together and, you know, creating even greater change. And, you know, this guy, you know, is very blunt and uses a lot of, you know, paradigm and dichotomy analogies and stuff. And when he says something, he kind of rants like I do and goes into exactly why he said it, exactly, you know, what his motives are and the point that he's making. So in a way, he just, the way he presents himself reminds me a lot of, you know, the discussions and stuff that, you know, we've had right here on PSEC. Of course, you know, he didn't use any George Carlin or Bill Hicks style comedy or innuendo or, you know, swear or anything like that. But, you know, kind of like we do a bit here. But, you know, I thought it was really cool the way he's doing this. And because he's more about paradigm shifting than anything, and this guy's like, you know, it's not about, you know, selling anything. He makes all his money from, you know, from other stuff. So it's like, you know, him, you know, having this information package available to work with is, you know, not his main bread and butter. And, you know, he talks about all the different, like, self-help stuff and all this, and there's these packages out there that, you know, there are some people who put these things together and sell them for a lot of money, but there's really no integrity in it, and it just ends up falling on its face. And, you know, all these scams and stuff. And he's just like, well, you know, something's not a scam if it actually works. And, you know, something is a scam if it takes from you and, you know, doesn't give anything in return. That's one thing I love about the internet, the idea of customer reviews. You know, if a product is really good, people are going to be talking about it. If a product really sucks, people are going to be talking about it. But because it is about the paradigm shifting, I mean, You can look through his, you know, his YouTube channel here, and he's just got tons and tons and tons of videos on all sorts of different topics, you know, similar to what we do here on PSEC, you know, similar to what Katarina Edwards and a lot of other people have done. I mean, you know, he's just got all these different topics and all these different subjects that he talks on. And, you know, like this one here, a message to the rioters and police of Baltimore from Tai Lopez. So, you know, talks about world event stuff too. What if your family sucks? Right thing at the right time. Are you an ass? Tai Lopez on people, on pleasing everyone, mentors, and the two extremes to avoid, so on and so forth. And to give you a little sample of what he's about, I'm going to play right quick, and it's short, the are you an ass and the, you know, the pleasing and so on and so forth, because that seems to be like a really big one with me and a lot of people today as far as that sort of topic, because it just seems that a lot of people are really just trying to please everybody, and it's a very common dysfunction that society programs into us. And I just do my best to tell people that no matter what you do, no matter what you say, there's no way in hell you're going to freaking please everybody. No matter what, you know, no matter what you do, what you say, there's always going to be people who like you, always people who can't stand you. It's just, there's no avoiding that. And to expect everybody to like you, or to expect yourself to like everybody, or whatever, all this appeasement stuff, it's pure Nazism, like straight up, like no joke. And for those idiots, I mean people out there who think of the word Nazism and associate it only with the Holocaust because their minds are so fucking narrow. No child left behind. Nazism is referring to an ideology, not one particular event in history. Nazism is that, you know, that Nazism, fascism, that control freaky, you know, creepy mentality that everybody's got to think the same way, everybody's got to do the same things, and that really yucky, nasty, energetic vampirism ideology, that is freaking Nazism. So it's just really stupid, like, when I say something's Naziistic and some fucking moron pops off with, That's an exaggeration, because what you're talking about has nothing to do with the mass murder of Jews in World War II. It's like, oh my god. Narrow-minded, hello. See, I'm just gonna play this real quick, and then Rich can chime in with his comments and stuff on that too after I play this, because he's here. So, let's see. Let's get this rolling.
You know, it took me a long time in life to realize that there's two extremes when it comes to trying to please people. The first one is trying to please nobody, because some people go, I just live for myself. I think that's a false reality. You can't just live for yourself. It's not realistic in a world of 7.3 billion people and an economy where to make money and survive, you have to interact and please other people. Like the great Peter Drucker said, the purpose of a business is to satisfy customers' desires, those desires they know about, or in some cases, like Steve Jobs and Bill Gates and Twitter guys, they satisfied desires people didn't even know they had. But nonetheless, they were satisfying desires. So that's one extreme. People say, I just live for myself. I think it's a weak-minded and impossible way to live. Secondly, you have people who try to please everybody. And if you're at my conference, I was talking about that my favorite Aesop's fable, you know, it's the son and his dad, and they've got a donkey, and they're going to town to sell their farm stuff, and the son starts out on the donkey, the dad's pulling it, a couple people walk by, and they, you know, whisper under their breath, what kind of son makes his dad walk, you know, kind of inconsiderate, rude son. So the son feels bad, he gets off the donkey, the dad gets off the donkey. Some people walk by, strangers, and say, what kind of dad, you know, makes his, an able-bodied dad makes his son walk. So dad feels bad. They both get up on the donkey. Some people walk by, you know, they're animal rights, they're from PETA, and they say, what kind of people make their donkey carry them? You know, animal cruelty. So the dad and the son feel bad. They get off the donkey, and then they're going further. Some people walk by and say, what kind of idiots have a donkey and nobody rides on it? So at the end of the story, the dad and the son come into town, and they're carrying the donkey. And they're going across the bridge, but the donkey's heavy because it's got all the stuff on it. And they accidentally fall, and everybody goes into the bridge, into the river and dies. And the moral of the story is you can't please all the people all the time. So try to not be an extremist. You know, what I think the answer is, and that's why I'm so big on mentors and who you hang out with, you pick a small select group of people, and those are the people that you make sure that you please. You know, I have mental models in my head. I've got guys like my mentor, Joel Salatin. You know, I obviously, Joel and I are different. We have some different beliefs on things, but in the end game, I feel like I'm off track if Joel would look at my life and think it's completely wacky. You know, so it's not that I'm trying to please Joel, but there's nothing wrong with having the whispers in your head of people that you respect. So you need to pick a handful of people. I got three or four people in mind, and I also have groups of people that I would like to please, quote unquote. And then if people aren't in that circle, I don't really care if I'm pleasing them or not. I think that's the happy balance. Be selective on who you live to please. You should obviously want to please your own, you know, yourself. That's a given. But that's, again, not a realistic. The way that the human brain works, Jonathan Haidt talks about this. There's a great book called Social by Lieberman. I think he's at Harvard or UCLA. And he talks about how our brain works, how you must have some, you must satisfy people outside of yourself to be self-satisfying. It's a little, you know, it's kind of an oxymoron. There's some irony there, but that's how we work. But you don't want to be like that Aesop's fable and be walking through life. I see that all the time. People trying to please everybody in their family, everybody at work, everybody that they encounter. You just won't do it. In fact, I talk about this. If you're in my business program, my entrepreneur program, I talk about the law of 18%. Like, you want to alienate some people. That means you're living a life, you know, a bold life. If you make a YouTube channel and every comment is positive, you're probably not being honest enough with the world. If you're honest with the world will not, not everybody in this world will love you. I can tell you that. People have tremendous.
As I like to say, if you're not at least pissing some people off, you're probably doing something wrong.
And as dysfunctions, neurosis, fears, and selfish intentions that don't align with the good, for sure, your own good, and probably not society. So who do you care about? You should list it. You should list out a name of a handful of people that you don't, if you were on that donkey and they walked by and said, hey, you know, you're off track, that you would actually stop and maybe change your course. You definitely need some people, because some people I know think they know everything. You will need outside advice. I don't care how much money. I had a guy, you know, at my house the other day, a couple of entrepreneurs making, you know, good money, close to $1 million a month or whatever. But there's people out there making 10 million bucks a month. So you never get a big head to the point where you go, you know, oh, I know what I'm doing. You never know what you're doing. You never know what you're doing. You just hope at the end of the day that you're on the right track. That's what matters. Kind of like a racetrack. Just make sure you're running around it. You can run around it forever, and you will be running around that track of life till the day you breathe your last breath. Make sure you don't get off in the grass. And the best way to do that is not be extreme and not pleasing anybody or trying to please too many people. So let me know what you think. Subscribe here, and I'll talk to you soon.
I think you have some experience dealing with that paradigm, Rich. Although, don't worry, I don't have any metal batons with me or anything, but yeah.
I just came back. I kind of went for a break there for a second. I just came back at the latter end of that video, but yeah.
Yeah, it's about people trying to please everybody.
Uh-huh.
You know, and he told the Aesop's fable about the father and the son and the donkey, and, you know.
Well, hey, you know, he's being genuine in his expression, and
do you know
he's
that
standing
one?
Up for what's right, and you know, he's doing what he needs to do.
You know that one about the father and the son and the donkey?
Not ringing any bells at the moment, no.
All right. I'll just jump to that part and let him retell it. I mean, I've heard this one before. I think it's a good one.
You know, it took me a long time in life. You know, they're animal rights. They're from PETA. And they say, they're a rude son. So the son feels, the dad's pulling it. A couple people walk. My favorite Aesop's fable, you know, it's the son and his dad. And they've got a donkey and they're going to town to sell their farm stuff. And the son starts out on the donkey, the dad's pulling it, a couple people walk by, and they, you know, whisper under their breath, what kind of son makes his dad walk, you know, kind of inconsiderate, rude son. So the son feels bad, he gets off the donkey, the dad gets off the donkey. Some people walk by, strangers, and say, what kind of dad, you know, makes his, an able-bodied dad makes his son walk. So dad feels bad. They both get up on the donkey. some people walk by, you know, they're animal rights, they're from PETA, and they say, what kind of people make their donkey carry them? You know, animal cruelty. So the dad and the son feel bad. They get off the donkey, and then they're going further. Some people walk by and say, what kind of idiots have a donkey and nobody rides on it? So at the end of the story, the dad and the son come into town, and they're carrying the donkey. And they're going across the bridge, but the donkey's heavy because it's got all the stuff on it. And they accidentally fall, and everybody goes into the bridge, into the river and dies. And the moral of the story is, you can't please all the people all the time. So try to not be an extremist. You know, what I think the answer is, and that's why I'm so big on mentors and who you hang out with.
Okay. So I'll pause it there, but yeah, that's the little table.
I like it. That's true. Yeah, you spend your whole life living on your knees instead of on your feet, you're going to die a defeated and weak person. Sometimes standing up for the right thing is the hard thing to do, but, you know, that is a truth that you have to learn to accept in life. You cannot and never will be able to please every person you see. Everybody, you know, there's equally a number of potentially friendly people out there as there are mean and spiteful people. But, you know, just because somebody looks at you and snickers under their breath or says something or, you know, whatever, doesn't mean you have to stop being you and feel guilty, you know. No, he's standing up, as I was saying earlier, he's standing up for his own genuine expression. He's doing his own thing, and, you know, he's successful, and he's in alignment with himself, and, you know, he's just another uplifting spirit out there that means what he says and stands by it, you know. And the fact that, you know, he's successful because of that is just, it's uplifting, it's a signpost, it's, you know, it's just yet again another signpost that says you're headed in the right direction, you know.
Yeah, I mean, in the original video I watched with him, he covered a lot of topics, including, you know, the Nazism of the frickin', you know, educational system, the whole, you know, 20th century was pretty much just like industrial frickin', you know, slavery, and, you know, how we're just all taught to obey, but we're not taught to think, and that, you know, we're moving, you know, we've moved out of the idea of, oh, everybody's got to work for somebody else, and now in the 21st century, there's, you know, the idea of entrepreneurs and, you know, making money online and, you know, being a self-made person and whatever, and the tools for that that are available and that continue to become more available and more tools is astronomical. This is also something the globalists should definitely worry about. But, you know, as I've said before, just because, you know, you have a hammer doesn't make you, like, the world's best freaking, you know, fence designer. That doesn't magically get bestowed upon you simply just because you have the hammer. Any good tool, if you don't know how to use it, or if you're using it irresponsibly, you can land yourself in disaster. And we like to blame the tools instead of taking personal responsibility. That's, you know, the war on drugs, the war on this, the war on that. Ban guns, ban this, blah, blah, blah. God forbid people just take personal responsibility and go, all right, well, why is this happening? Oh, people are narrow-minded and stupid. Every child left behind. What should we do? Oh, maybe some critical thinking and discernment. That might be fucking helpful. So, you know, I like it that, you know, within the stuff this guy says and, you know, the way, as far as what he explained in the other longer video that I'm not going to play, but the one that, you know, he outlines what his little, you know, online access does for people and, you know, how it's really just about paradigm shifting and encouraging people to think critically. I mean, I think that's awesome because all these different tools are available, you know, for people to, you know, not only be more financially independent, but, you know, learn to expand their minds more and their imaginations and really, you know, be the change, you know, that they want to create in the world. There's all these wonderful tools to do that, but it does take time to learn to use these tools, and it does take time to learn to think critically and use discernment and intuition and stuff if you're not really already too fluent on how to do that. And there's, you know, lots of, you know, ways to do that too, and all this stuff is just totally available to humanity right now, and it's awesome, but it is a slow process. So, like, well, it's not like snail's pace slow. I mean, it's like a bullet out of a freaking gun. It's lightning fast the way humanity's, you know, evolving and changing. But as far as from the perspective of the individual in the now moment, and the fact that it does take one's time at one's pace to learn how to do anything, can't, you know, plant a tree seed today and have a 40-foot tree tomorrow and so on, then, you know, yeah, there's definitely personal processes, and people do have this idea about, you know, being afraid of things taking time, which leads to that instant gratification and freaking, you know, neurosis and fear of anything taking time. And one other thing that he had said in this other video, he says there's an old Amish saying, a fence that goes up too quickly comes down even quicker. So it's basically, if you don't take the time and you do everything half-assed, you're building a very weak structure, and it's just going to get blown down. It's just going to get torn apart. It's not going to be able to, you know, survive change. So, I mean, I don't know how many more people there are out there like this guy. Obviously, even with the internet, no one can know how many of each type of person are out there and how many of what or who is doing exactly what. There's just so much information out there, it's easy to get lost in the shuffle. But as more people emerge who are doing this, then obviously, you know, the people who are into this sort of stuff, being like-minded, you know, they slowly start to come into the awareness of, you know, other people doing similar things. And I think before long, just like anything else, you're going to start having websites that have, you know, internet lists of people and programs and tools and things, and it's quickly going to become a common phenomenon, and it's going to popularize the idea even more. The idea that I'm talking about is that, you know, that idea of self-education, that, you know, you don't absolutely need to attend a particular school and get degrees and whatever for most things. I mean, some things you do if you want to be a lawyer, a brain surgeon, or something that incredibly specialized, you know, of course, you're going to want to go to college for that. But for most things, all you need is the knowledge. I mean, even MIT has all their classes on YouTube for free, recorded. And that's not going to get you a diploma at MIT. But if you're just interested in obtaining the knowledge that they're teaching, then that's there for you for free. And we need to realize that having knowledge and learning how to apply it to be the change we want to create is more important than getting a mark of approval called a diploma or a certification or whatever, where the aristocracy checkmarks you off and says, okay, you're not violating any of our sacred cows, so we approve of you. Well, why is their opinion so, you know, goddamn almighty anyway?
Yeah, exactly. I mean, you know, society still buys into the scam that you have to have a piece of paper to be smart. And I can tell you right now, there are some of the dumbest, most ignorant pieces of shit out there have a piece of paper, and it means literally nothing. Literally nothing. They did nothing to get it. You know, a piece of paper doesn't say anything about you as an individual. It doesn't say anything about you, you know, as a person. It just, it's, what is a piece of paper? You know, that's all a degree is. It's a piece of paper. I'm not saying education isn't important, and if you're already in school and you're applied and you're working hard and you're getting there, keep going. And, you know, that's the only way you can do it right now is using the system. I'm not saying shun the system. That's the only way you're going to be able to, you know, go forward right now if you're already in.
Just don't get into the debt scams. I mean, if you already have the money for college, or you can get a full grant, or excuse me, you can go to a cheaper college that, you know, gets you to the same place you want to go, then, you know, cool. Just don't become an indentured, you know, wage debt fucking slave for the rest of your life. But I mean, yeah, like Rich is saying, if you, you know, if you're already into that and you're not going about it in a debt slave sort of way, and, you know, you've got it paid for and you're happy with the service that you're getting, and you're not sitting there in class going, oh my God, what is this bullshit? This is so lame. This is not fucking helpful. Then, you know, if you're in college and it's been a good experience and you feel you're, you know, you're getting your money's worth, then, you know, then obviously that's working for you. But if you're a high school dropout with no diploma, that doesn't mean it's the end of the world. You can still be self-educated and, you know, even make millions of dollars and whatever.
Even though the system will try to discourage you and say, oh, that's one in a million, that the likelihood of that, you know, they try to pull a C-3PO.
Yeah.
Say the odds are 1,799,000 to 1. Good luck, you know. Even though they themselves are totally miserable and deprived of anything happy that they've ever had. I'm not saying all teachers out there that way. If there are any teachers listening, if you're a critical thinking and smart teacher, your tax, you are well spent in terms of tax dollars. I'm talking about colleagues whom are unmotivated, who are Nazis in their way of thinking, who are literal dregs on humanity. Who want to have a dialogue.
Of Nazis.
We all know who those people are. Yes, I'm talking to you, Mr. Crouch. Don't be crouching in on our PSEC hangout that you still have not been brave enough to show up for.
I'm going to DMCA your YouTube video because I don't like you. And that didn't go well for him.
Yeah, it's not going to go well again.
Counterclaim. Video goes back up. Bring on the butthurt. But yeah, I mean, you know, that's another thing, because the system fails kids, and then kids make education synonymous with failure, and then they don't want anything to do with it. And, you know, it's just nice to see people out there that are just kind of breaking that and showing people that are like, hey, you know, the system is fucked. That doesn't mean we shouldn't educate ourselves. This means the system's pretty fucked. But there are, you know, lots of means to educate yourself despite the system. And, you know, granted, the old paradigm of, oh, it's one in a million to make it on your own or whatever, like, that was true, like, at the heart of this paradigm, like, midstream of it, to where, you know, it's like the 1950s and 60s or whatever, and getting more industrialized, and there wasn't as much frontier land, and most people didn't own farms, and more people in the cities, and, you know, before all this technology we have now, like, yeah, for a time that was true, but it hasn't been true for like 30 years. Look at fucking Bill Gates and Steve Jobs and, you know, all these people we know about that prove the point that it hasn't been true for 30 years. And then, of course, you know, all the people you might not know about, you know, like this guy, that are out there doing their thing. So, like, there's tons of people that are, you know, being self-educated and taking their knowledge and applying it and becoming successful with it, and they don't have a zillion degrees, and some of them don't even have high school diplomas. Then, you know, obviously we're seeing that the system is a fail, and that, you know, new constructs are continuing to emerge to, you know, supplement the system and eventually completely replace the system. I think eventually school isn't going to be a physical building anyone goes into. It's going to be just a global repository of knowledge and information that everybody could take from and deposit into, and then people decide what they want to do with it. So like, if people want to take certain aspects of knowledge and get together in person and, you know, have little social community things and, like, you know, do what they're doing in Seattle, like with the Beacon Food Forest, and actually making, like, you know, a real freaking self-sustaining food forest, so that, you know, to help defeat hunger, that's available to the public. Anyone could just come in there and eat from there. Or, you know, woofing farms, or, you know, I mean, there's all sorts of different projects, you know, agricultural, technological, all sorts of stuff that's wonderful, that, you know, the main thing that's required to make it happen is a bunch of, you know, educated, like-minded people coming in and cooperating. By educated, I don't mean they have a piece of paper. I mean, they've done their homework. That's all. Just, you know, not that they have to have a degree or diploma or whatever, but I think in the future, education is just going to be knowledge that's available to all from all, and people can take that knowledge and then apply it in all these different various directions, and it's going to be something completely different than what we're used to right now. And you're going to see like tons of freaking businesses always popping up, and that it's not hurting the economy for that to happen. That's what I think the future of education is going to be. And you're going to see 60-year-olds taking advantage of it just as much as 15-year-olds. And everybody's just going to be learning from everybody else, and I think it's going to be pretty cool. I mean, I can't tell you exactly what that system looks like or exactly how it's going to function, but I think the internet as it stands is a pretty good glimpse into the possibilities for the future. And especially with portable devices now, it's like people don't need to be chained to their desks at home. Like they could be, you know, working on projects and whatever on their portable devices while, you know, fucking hiking through the woods and feeding the deer or something. I mean, you know, it's like we're not chained to a desk anymore. We've got our technology. We've got our freedom of mobility. And, you know, the sky's really the limit. So, any further thoughts on that?
Well, yeah, I mean, that's pretty much, you know, the gist of it. I mean, you know, as humanity progresses in its maturation process, you know, people are already starting to get to that point. You know, they're realizing that there's more genuine ways that something can be done. It doesn't have to be done with the same old dysfunctional belief system of, oh, well, if it's not done this way, it's not legitimate, or, you know, if you have to go to this building called school to be smart, you know, people are starting to realize that's a crock of shit. You know, yeah, the internet is calling it out for what it is. You know, knowledge is something that you obtain on your own, not something that you obtain from some guy that tells you to absorb, not think, and repeat what you've been told, you know. That's not knowledge. If that's your definition of knowledge, you haven't learned anything.
I forgot if it was David Sharp or David Wood, but one of them said something to the effect of education is a process of learning, teaching, and doing simultaneously, and that is actual education. Although I simply just like to call it sharing. And, you know, as this sort of thing progresses, it's like, you know, there's people that, you know, they think, oh, well, we need to rise up against the globalists and have a revolution or a civil war. We got to kick the bums out of office and this and that and so on and so forth. But that doesn't resolve the paradigms in the heads of the masses, that even if they did all that, they would just be right back to, you know, freaking square one again, because they'd still want babysitters to rule them, and they'd still, you know, be thinking in the same terms as they were. So it's like, if you want to change all the fish in the ocean, what's easier, changing the entire ocean thereby affecting all the fish, or catching out each fish one by one? So as the environment in the world around these globalist elites or aristocracy or corporatocracy or corporate whores or 1% or whatever buzzword you want to use, Illuminati, the cabal, blah, blah, whatever. Doesn't matter what you use, whatever floats your boat, but whatever you want to represent that. The more we change the environment around them, it'll get to a point where, like, it doesn't even matter if they try to pull any sneaky shit. It won't work. There's just going to be, you know, no compatibility. And it'd be like, okay, they can try to start the car, but if there's no battery in the car and the gas tank is empty, well, it doesn't matter that they keep trying to start the car. The car just ain't going to start. So the more the world shifts into these new paradigm ideas where we're, you know, cooperating and putting things together instead of pulling things apart and bickering and bitching and waving our fucking dicks and doing all this energetic vampirism, freaking ego games, I am William Black, my way or the highway, fuck you. The more we get out of that attitude and, you know, move into the just, you know, respecting everybody's rights to be themselves, working with people who you resonate with, and people who don't resonate with you, let them go. It's a really peaceful transition if you just let them go. There's only drama and chaos if you try to, like, hold them in your reality against their will. And you're like, no, you have to like me, otherwise, blah, blah. That's just totally Naziistic, and that shit just needs to stop. I think we're seeing the beginnings of the stopping of that process. It might take another 10 or 20 years, or it could really surprise me and only take another 3. I don't know exactly how long it's going to take or not. I just know that progress is exponential, especially where technology is involved. You know, we advance at least, you know, twice, you know, at least double within a year's time on every level. So, you know, it's going to be slower than we'd like, but quicker than we'd think. And I think we're watching the beginnings of the world just transforming into something a lot better. But in that process, you know, we got to face our mess and clean it up. And a lot of that is very unpleasant, you know. So I'm not saying it's going to be easy. I'm not being new agey. You know, you can't just meditate there and try to ascend to the freaking fifth dimension while you're watching the world fucking burn and shit. You can't do nothing and be complacent. But, you know, this shift is happening. And I just think it's kind of like a natural progression of human evolution, kind of like, you know, we went from, you know, primitive humans all the way up to, you know, where we are now. And of course, you know, it can be debated as to whether or not we were an advanced civilization before that destroyed itself and is starting over, or what the case is, or if we were put here by aliens or whatever the case may be. That's all irrelevant. That goes back to biblical fall of man stories and shit like that. But I think it's a natural process of evolution where, you know, we're starting off simple and we keep growing in complexity and making mistakes and learning lessons. And we're just at that next stage of evolution where all the old mistakes are being identified and done away with, and we're figuring out how to do things in better ways. I think we're like, you know, like, I'm reminded of Rochelle. She's a new PSEC admin on the Facebook page, Rochelle DeYoung. So you're going to see her participating more. But she just turned 18 not too long ago. And I think that's very representative of what the entirety of humanity is doing. Like, we've been in this, you know, adolescent, teenage sort of level of consciousness where, you know, it's like, you know, fights in the schoolyard, you know, sort of a mentality. And now we've just kind of, you know, past a marker, and we're just kind of graduating into a more mature human race. And, you know, that does require, you know, dealing with our demons, facing our shit, cleaning up messes, taking personal responsibility. So a lot of it can be very unpleasant, but, you know, a lot of it's also pretty cool. So all I could suggest is just do the best you can and enjoy the journey.
Yeah, totally. I mean, you know, yeah, people are growing up and taking their own initiative and putting the responsibility where it belongs on them. I mean, I still see a lot of immaturity out there where people blame, you know, like especially me, you know, I work as a cashier and I see all kinds of different paradigms walk through that door every day. I see people who are upstanding citizens who are really good people who got their shit together, and then I see other people who, I kid you not, just need a bullet through their head because they're just...
Hey, careful about that. Careful about those types of phrasings. The last time you said somebody needed to be beaten with a metal baton, something happened that totally violates your rights. To be talked about later at another point in time. But be careful about those types of phrasings.
I'm not saying anybody in particular. That's a pretty bland statement. That can't be really twisted. And, yeah, I know. I'm just saying, you know, there are people who walk through that door who look so miserable that it's like, you know, as the saying goes, take me out, take it. You know, just take me out. I'm miserable. And, you know, they need a bullet through their head. I'm not saying anybody's name. I'm just saying I see people who are so down-looking, you know, they're 400 pounds or 800 pounds, you know, get into the truck, and the truck freaking tilts on one set of wheels, and then the truck shakes back and forth. I kid you not. They're that heavy.
Paradigms are just shit. Yeah. I think the worst of everything.
Yeah, and they eat garbage, and they look like garbage, and they gurgitate garbage, and... They, you know, they are what they eat, you know, as the Bible would put it. So, you know, yeah, the only thing they'd have look forward to is a bullet in their head. I mean, they're just that miserable. And they're assholes, a lot of them. And then there's other truckers who walk through there who are some of the most wonderful, kind-hearted people, you know, that are just great people, all-around good people, family men. Family women, I mean, just really, really good people that just mean well and, you know, find the work in a tough economy and just do it, making a living somehow, you know. But I see all different paradigms walk through that door. You know, those who need a bullet in their head and, or, you know, want a bullet in their head or whatever, you know, whatever the saying is for that. And those who...
People that are hopelessly on a downward spiral.
There you go.
People that, like, if you think your life sucks, cheer yourself up by looking at them.
Exactly. And I see a lot of examples like that at school, you know, people who've had DUIs and people who've, you know, been on a hard path and had their licenses revoked, and, you know, and I even have coworkers at work who've had stuff like that happen to them, you know. I'm not gonna say who, you know. Some who've been able to dust off and become productive individuals and find better work, and others who, you know, just kind of down on their luck and, you know, are on a downward spiral, as it were, and, you know.
I know there's one coworker in particular who you said that they are the poster child of downward spiral. I'm not going to go into details, but... But anyway. I think if anybody from your work was watching this, even that vague reference, you'd all be pointing to the same person and going, "Oh, I know who he's talking about."
Exactly. I mean, it's just kind of whatever. I mean, you know, yeah, there's just a lot of crazy stuff that goes on at work. You know, it is what it is, and, you know, but anyway, I mean, back on the track with humanity and all that, I mean, you know, yeah, I notice it with people there, you know. I'll get into some interesting conversations with people who are aware of what's going on, and, you know, the general consensus to me seems to be that people are waking up, except those who are on a downward spiral and need a bullet in their head because they just got nothing else left to look forward to because they've already been fluoridated and degradated and, you know, whatever else. but you know.
Oh, by the way, everybody, Richard looks really, really different than you might be used to seeing him. Turn on your camera. Oh, you got a little bit of fuzz there. Last time I saw you, it was like completely clean shaven.
Yeah, it comes back, but yeah, you still get the picture. It's
the first time I had ever seen you with a completely clean shave.
Yeah, I haven't shaved it in a year, so.
Yeah. I mean, I got the early balding thing going on, so it's like, I don't know how easy it's going to be to see. Let me try to turn on a better light or get some better lighting here. Come on, lighting. There we go. So, like, right now, I haven't done the total, like, clean shave. So, you know, you can see the black of the hair starting to grow back in and stuff like that. And, you know, I'll shave that sooner or later, depending on how lazy I'm feeling or not. But in the meantime, just wear a hat. And, you know, sometimes I'll have, you know, I've gotten a little lazy and, you know, some stuff growing out here. And I got the beard and the mustache and everything. Other times I'll have the beard and the mustache like extremely thin, and other times I'll just like shave it off just completely. I've got many different looks.
Yep, as we all do. But anyway, as I was saying, back on point, you know, from the people whom I've talked to who are aware and awake and know what's up, you know, it seems to me that the general consensus between those individuals is, you know, society in its current state is totally fucked. Just totally and utterly screwed in its current state. And you look around and you see how spoiled we are in Western culture and how arrogant we are. And you could easily say, yeah, America's kind of like the modern Rome. I mean, you know, shit in a bucket and your servant or whatever tosses it out the window for you because you're too lazy to do it yourself. I mean, we kind of live in decadence, but, you know, that's just the current societal situation. That's kind of how the elites have programmed everything, you know, through state of mind, you know, the societal malware and everything else. You know, we've just turned it, essentially society's turned into a society of just lazy slobs and bums. And unfortunately, there's a minority of us in there who are just kind of looking around with this just kind of like disbelief, if you will. Some of us more than others are in disbelief. Some of us are just like, yep, is what it is. Just another squirrel out in bloated, tumorous GMO squirrel out on the GMO grass, you know, under the nice chemtrail sky. You know, it's just kind of, just is what it is.
Well, at least things have gotten to the point where even the biggest dumbass is starting to realize that there is something wrong, even if they can't totally put their finger on it. They're starting to get general vague sense. Like, you know, something doesn't quite seem right anymore. Whereas, like, in the past, it was just like, there's no problem. Shut up. Everything's fine. Our economy's great. You're stupid. You're anti-American if you think something's wrong. Fuck you. And now even the dumbest idiots are starting to realize, you know, something does kind of feel a little off now.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah. And I mean, it's really refreshing. I mean, you know, people who were just kind of in denial of it a couple of years ago are now, it's common knowledge now that society is in a low, low state. And that, you know, people are coming to the realization at this point, but people have yet to really ask the questions, well, why is it this way? Who is doing this? People are still blaming it on, you know, just kind of the surface issues like, oh, well, it's Obama, or oh, it's, you know, Jesse Jackson, or oh, it's this political figure over here, or it's that political figure that's causing this, it's Hillary, it's, you know, insert puppet name here. People haven't really gotten to the idea of, oh, well, my vote doesn't mean anything. I tried to vote for the opposite candidate last time, but yet the other candidate who didn't have a snowball's chance in hell still got in. And that just makes me, you know, people haven't gotten to the idea yet that maybe their vote doesn't mean anything. A lot of people did wake up in the last election and finally come to a conclusion of, oh shit, my vote means literally nothing. It literally means jack diddly squat in the current system. You know, and I think what's going to have to happen is people are going to have to do it again. People are going to have to vote again and realize the hard way that, oh, well, I guess my vote doesn't mean anything because Hillary Clinton got in. And we all know the popular vote was towards the other candidate, but yet again, the system is so rigged and so full of shit that, you know, they put in whoever the hell they want to put in who backs their agenda the best. And not, and then people start asking the questions, well, who's buying the votes? Who's funding these politicians? Who's in the background? Who's overhead? Who's holding the puppet strings up? Those are the questions that people have yet to ask. People are still blaming the surface of the problem. They're not realizing.
When I was a teenager and I was taking this U.S. Constitution class, like, I didn't give it too much thought at the time, but there was one question that popped up in my mind, and I do believe I asked the teacher. I forgot what they said. I don't know, but we were learning about the Electoral College, and I was like, wait a minute. If the Electoral College is able to take all the votes and then quietly, without telling anybody, flip them all just the way they want it to be, then how does your vote actually count? Like if Illinois votes majority for one candidate, but then the Electoral College can say, well, you know, we don't really like that that happens, so let's flip it the other way, then how is that, you know, any sort of fair, legitimate voting system? It's only an illusion that makes people think that, you know, they have a vote, but really the corporate powers in control that control the Electoral College are just going to flip the vote any which damn way they want. And then, of course, you know, some of the people on the smaller echelons of politics, especially with the new computerized voting system, started getting the same idea, like, oh, well, we could outplay the Electoral College because we could slip in this code in these voting systems and hack the voting systems and alter the vote the way we want it, and ha, ha, ha. So it's just like, yeah, when I first came across that, I was like, what the fuck?
Well, yeah, that's another good point, Dave. And, yeah, I mean, I remember, you know, going over that one in eighth grade history class. It doesn't matter if your state votes 90% conservative, 10% liberal. If the Electoral College person for your state is liberal and they have a bias, they're gonna lean with the liberal minority as opposed to the conservative majority. See, they're gonna go. And that's just using the example of the system we have now, or, you know, say in another state where there's a liberal majority, God forbid, and there's a conservative minority. If the guy's conservative, well, fortunately for the conservatives get the vote. But of course, if that were the case, it would be in the news, and there would be questions of voting fraud and corruption and all that stuff, because that's just how the system's wired. You know, if you stand for red, white, and blue, and you're a patriot, and, you know, you're a gun owner, and you're Christian, well, you're just an enemy, and blah, blah, blah. You know, the modern Jew. But anyway, it's just kind of funny, you know, if somebody's got a particular bias or they stand politically to one side, you know, it doesn't matter how many people vote for, you know, the conservative candidate or the Republican candidate as opposed to the liberal democratic socialist candidate, they're still going to choose, you know, the minority pick just because they're twinged in bias or whatever else you want to say. You know, they're just going to throw the bias out there. They're going to, you know, they're going to choose what they feel they want to choose. Fuck what everybody else has to say. I'm the Electoral College. I get to make that choice for everybody. So, you know, yeah, the system as is fucked. You know, a minority gets to choose what the majority gets, which is unequal, not fair representation. You know, it's like the old saying goes on taxation without representation is tyranny. You know, well, voting fraud without, you know, backing up the majority of voters is tyranny as well. I mean, you know, it's just one snivelly little weasel in some office somewhere saying, well, this is what I like, and everybody else can just go die and jump off a cliff. This is who we're voting for. My vote goes to this candidate. Screw everybody else. And that's not a fair system. It's a totally bought and paid for system. It was a bought and paid. The modern electoral system is, you know, it was manufactured from the ground up to be assaulted, to be taken over. Now, the principles behind our electoral college and, you know, our system of government came in good intention, but unfortunately, the globalists have found those weaknesses and have taken the fullest advantage of them that they can, and they've been doing it for quite some time, at least the last 130 years. And, you know, we now see the final product of what that's brought us, which is what Thomas Jefferson warned about, a two-party dictatorship, you know, where there's basically a monkey in the middle. The masses just kind of get pulled into the opposite corners of the slaughter pen. And, you know, one side says, you know, red side bad. And the other side says blue side bad. And, you know, the masses split themselves and bicker amongst each other like little children about, you know, who's better than the other just based on the color or the marital status of the number five, or, you know, this candidate is pro-tuna sandwich and the other one's anti-tuna sandwich. Well, I like tuna, so this one's better. I mean, it's stupid shit like that. You might as well compare politics to that, modern American politics. I remember when I was in seventh grade, before I really had an understanding of candidates, when I was a pro-Bush, you know, candidate, just because my family was, I remember, you know, being in seventh grade art class and we'd just bicker amongst each other, you know, going, oh, well, George Bush is better because, you know, or no, Barack Obama's better because, or no, you know, John McCain's better because, you know, and it's like, and I look back on it, and it's like, that literally was, you know, and I look at adults today, like if you watch Fox News or CNN, it's the same kind of stuff. They're screaming at each other over stupid talking points that are, you know, both sides. It's just nothing more than just a little mind control device. It's just designed to control your mind. It's designed to manipulate all the little emotions inside your head, and it scrambles your brain. That's all it does. There's true politics, which, you know, is intellectually informing and stimulating. And then there's baby politics, which is which flavor of Gerber tastes better. Oh, well, John McCain likes banana nut pudding, and Mr. Obama likes South African beef jerky with biltong sauce mashed up in the, you know, it's the same kind of crap. And it's just like, you feel your mind literally just kind of run out your ear and onto your shoulder and just kind of sit there and like have an aneurysm. It's that kind of level of dumb stuff. It's like, who cares? Am I supposed to care? You know, I'm into intellectual news. I'm into politics. I'm into informative things. I'm into things that awaken my mind, that inspire me. I'm not into things that make my mind just want to commit habitual Harry Carey with a Japanese dagger. You know, no, I you know, I grew out of that in eighth grade, and I kind of saw what the bullshit scam was. And when I saw it, I caught on to it, and I've been pretty much preaching about it ever since. Anyway, that's my rant.
Alrighty then.
Uh-huh.
Have really much to add. I mean, I agree with you on pretty much all points, and I don't see a problem with anything you just said.
Yeah, I mean, you know, they kind of throw, I don't really understand the whole conservative bad, liberal, democratic, socialist good thing. I mean, it's just kind of like, that's just my last point, and after this we can close it out. But the main thing is I don't get it. It's like, if you support guns, you're an evil baby killer, you know, and you like George Bush, you know, if you like anything conservative, or you like anything that's somewhat liberal, or, you know, the people have this tenacity to label you as a, you know, gun-toting, you know, frothing at the mouth extremist. And it's like, no, I just like firearms. That's an American given right. You should at least respect that right. I'm not saying you have to like guns. I'm not saying you have to want to be around them. I'm not even saying you have to own one. You don't. Nobody's saying you have to own a firearm. That's a choice. That's a choice. It's a God-given choice. You don't have to own a gun. You can, but you don't have to. There's no, nobody's holding a knife to your throat or a gun to your head saying you have to own a gun to, you know, nobody's doing that. It's a choice. You know, the Second Amendment is actually probably one of the few amendments you really have a choice on. Well, next to freedom of speech and all that stuff, the right to say something when you want to say it. I mean, those are really the fundamental choice amendments. But see, I just don't get the whole media bias where they kind of they throw the dirt at one side and say that side is terrible, but yet nobody will question the side that's doing all of the slinging and all of the mud throwing. I mean, I look at the news nowadays, you know, I see the Democrats pound on the Republicans, even though I think the Republican Party has been full of shit. Well, both parties have been full of shit for the last 150 years, just totally full of shit. I mean, clear back to the Whig Party, if you will. I mean, all the candidates, you know, I'm not saying there haven't been good presidents between now and then. There have, that have done some good things for this country. You know, but it's just, you know, I don't get the bias, you know, on one side of the spectrum that just uses one side as a scapegoat, you know, like having them in a headlock and saying, you know, say uncle, you know, the whole time while they push all the buttons and pull all the strings. Well, I just don't get
it. Left-right paradigm ego games, like the societal idea that society says, okay, you're either this or you're that, pick one. Or if you're not this, then you must be that, as if there's only two options for everything.
Which is why,
you know, the lovey-lighty delusional New Agers think I'm a negative Alex Jonesy conspiracy theorist, and the negative Alex Jonesy conspiracy theorists think I'm a lovey-lighty New Ager, and the freaking Democrats think I'm a Republican, and the Republicans think I'm a Democrat, and just like, because I allow myself to agree with all sides of everything to an extent, to disagree with all sides of everything to an extent, and God forbid, even have my own thoughts, views, and opinions that neither side resonate with. So whenever either side sees that I'm not aligned with them on something, their automatic assumption is, oh, they must be the enemy camp. If they're not saying something that sounds Republican, they must be Democrat. If they're not saying something that sounds Democrat, they must be Republican. Ooh, he's talking about state of being and quantum physics again. Oh, he must be one of them New Agers. And they got like, oh, you know, he's talking about how we need to take negative circumstances and turn it into positive, but, you know, we have to shun the negative, otherwise it'll overpower us, and dark demons will live in our anus. And so he's talking about dark stuff, so he's one of them dark, yicky people that we need to stay away from. And, you know, it's just that sort of thing. And I just laugh at everybody, and I'm like, all right, cool, you know. And I just make this exact point that I'm making now, and just like, hey, nothing new under the fucking sun. So it's cool. You want to think that? Go ahead and think that.
Well, yeah. I mean, you know, but I mean, I just sit there anymore, you know, and it's like, you know, people think I have a hammer and sickle, like, you know, on my icon right now. You know, you can probably see this as I'm talking, but I mean, people are like, oh, well, because you have that, you're communist. And I'm like, well, really? That's the only thing you have to say on that matter. You don't know me personally. You don't know anything about me. So just making an assumption based on an internet icon that I have is pretty childish. I mean, it's like, and since Dave kind of did some clarification, kind of got my mind on a right track. I mean, really, when I think about it, this whole left-right paradigm bullshit is equivalent to like 2-3-year-olds sitting in a playpen arguing with each other and calling each other names and making faces at each other and pulling their mouths in weird directions and doing all that stuff. That's essentially what society's locked in terms of politics. I mean, that's, you know, they take their diaper off, they pull the crap out of it, and they throw it at each other, or, you know, I mean, just what next?
It's the same thing like me, you, and Kristen were talking about the other night when it comes to the idea of, like, you know, genuine, authentic, creative female expression, you know, versus fetishism, to where a girl will express herself in one way or another, and then, you know, some creepy fucker decides to make it into some sort of a fetish or something, and then how does society react? Everybody around, they automatically align with the creep, and they're like, okay, it's a fetish. There can be no other expression or perspective of that. It's a fetish, so now here's your choice. You're either pro the fetish or anti the fetish. So then the girl's just like, what the fuck? I wasn't talking or doing in any of those contexts at all. Here's actually what I was doing. And society's like, nope, we don't care what you say. You're lying to us. You're either defending the fetishists, or you're trying to cater to them, or you're a closet case fetishist, or you just don't know you're anti-fetish yet, and it's just like the whole, like, hey, you know, there are other options outside of this, you know, narrow-minded perspective that are actually possible, and, you know, how it gives females low self-esteem and makes them feel like them being themselves are not good enough because they try to express themselves, and society's like either saying, oh, no, you need to do that way, or this needs to be done that way, or, oh, if you do that, it means this. It doesn't mean what you're trying to say. As a society saying, like, hey, if we want your opinion, we'll give it to you. No, shut up. I am William Black. So, you know, it's just that type of shit with everything. And we just got to be, you know, just kind of brave and stand up and be like, well, if you want to think that, that's cool, but I'm not obligated to. And I live in America, and I'm an adult, and I have rights. So if you're going to make claim that I am obligated to hold the perspective you think that I should hold, then I need to see your legal proof of claim of authority over me. And if you cannot provide legal proof of claim, which you can't, then that means we're all entitled to our perspectives and views, and that's fine because this is America, and until it completely turns into the total Fourth Reich where, you know, we're all being tossed in camps and whatever, which probably won't happen either because of the rate of human consciousness expanding, so the globalists can forget that one. But either way, until this becomes a total dystopian tyranny to Mad Max Beyond the Thunderdome sort of levels, then that means I actually do have freedom. And so if you're trying to tell me that you're an authority over me and that I have to obey you, that reality, my reality must be what you say it must be, then I'm going to need legal proof, which I know you can't present. So then either you have your legitimate opinion or you're committing legal slander against me and I could sue you if I want to. So which is it? We either have the rights to all our opinions about each other or you're slandering me and I could sue you. Which one do you like better? If you're making a legal claim that is fraudulent, be like the equivalent of saying, hey, Rich, you do actually molest little children. You do. You did it at 3 p.m. yesterday. So, yeah, you child molester. And it's like, oh, well, where's your evidence? Well, I have none. You just are okay. So shut up. That's the sort of thing you can go to court over.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, you know, I just pitch it like that and people tend to shut up. Like, okay. Well, you know.
Because that's defamation of character, that's slander, and of course what I dealt with in court was slander. I mean, you know, they're just making a bunch of assumptions off of thin air speculation. You know, something I say out of a video that was clearly an opinion that, you know, for the record was an opinion, 110% an opinion, not a threat, not anything else. And what is, you know, said petitioner do, they, you know, throw a restraining order on me and say that I'm a wife-beaten, autistic, deranged weirdo who, isn't capable of having empathy for others and speaking it in the document as if though it's fact, which is totally,
individual that you're speaking of did claim that you were diagnosed with this, that, and the other, and that there's, that totally never happened, and there's no legal record or anything of that, and it's, you know, it's totally false, but, you know, you kind of walked it into the courtroom, and you're like, okay, judge, I want to present my case, and the judge is like, no, fuck you, you can't, you're guilty, because I say so, you shouldn't have been talking on the internet about anything, and fuck you, and, you know, that's basically what it boiled down to, and, you know, your due process was, you know, completely freaking railroaded, and, you know, that is the type of, you know, society that, that we live in now, that, you know, but either way, I mean, my original, the point that I was trying to make was just, you know, simply if someone's trying to throw their weight around and telling me how I have to think and how I have to feel and how I have to express, I'm just like, hey, you know, well, you can either provide legal proof of claim that you have authority over me to make those demands, or you can disrespect that we all have the right to our opinions. And if you're if you say that you have authority over me, then you need to provide legal proof of claim, which you can't, and then that's slander, and, you know, so on and so forth. So which is it? Are you legally slandering me and wanting to go to court over it, or do you have the right to think I'm a delusional shithead and I have the right to think you're a fucking idiot? Oh, we have rights? Okay, cool. No court needed then. We just all have the rights to think what we want to think. Ta-da! Simple.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. I mean, it's the intelligence of some people and the reasoning abilities of some people just absolutely astound me, especially, you know, given that whole instance of what I went through. I mean, it's just like, you know, I just roll my eyes every time and sometimes just laugh hysterically. It's just like, are you kidding me? Are you kidding me? It's like, you know, don't worry, there's going to be a lawsuit over this one, and it will happen at some point, and all parties involved will be guilty and found guilty and dealt with accordingly under the fullest extent of the law. But, you know, it's just, it's ridiculous. It's totally ridiculous. It's just absolutely, utterly ridiculous that, you know, there are people like that out there, but there are. And it's, you know, it is what it is. I mean, you know, that's just kind of what society is going through right now, you know, separating the wheat and the chaff, if you will. But anyway, that's just kind of my spiel for the night.
Yep. So yeah, there's a lot of good stuff happening, a lot of contrast happening, and, you know, like we were saying earlier, with the raise in human consciousness and all the technology that's there, and the internet and all these, you know, different entrepreneurial platforms and social media tools and, you know, so on and so forth, we not only have the opportunity to learn how to use the tools to improve our lifestyles and stuff, but also to, you know, to paradigm shift and overcome our own bullshit, you know, because Naziistic society is, you know, from through the educational system from little kids up, is, you know, filled our heads full of, you know, all this dysfunction that we continue to practice until adulthood becomes a state of extended adolescence. And just, you know, it's just kind of time to start, you know, deprogramming that. And, you know, I see a lot of that going on. You know, you see things like PSEC, you know, you see people like Tai Lopez, and you see Katarina Edwards, and you see platforms like TSU, and I mean, the list goes on and on and on. And as more and more people continue to wake up and think critically and use their imaginations and think, what am I good at? What can I do? How can I contribute to the, you know, the betterment of my life and subsequently the planet in the process? Then, you know, you just got more and more people getting creative and artistic and, you know, discussing ideas and implementing ideas. And it's a really exciting time in history to be alive, in my opinion, because there's just so much potential for just about anything and everything. It's like we're living in the era of like science fiction becoming science fact. Even all the technology we take for granted today, you know, even back in the 60s and 70s would have seemed like this outrageous futuristic technology that, you know, like, wow, you know, we won't have that for another few hundred years and we'll be flying around on starships and blah blah blah. But no, it all happens much sooner, you know, than we think. I mean, we've got it, broadband internet and wireless access and cell phones and laptops, and even the freaking cell phones are little computers. I mean, you got these little cell phones that are computers. You've got a Linux operating system installed.
You know, that's another point. Really, when I think about it, when it comes to innovations and paradigms, a lot of people look at, you know, frontiersmen as these negative, you know, it's like, oh, how dare you defy what's always been? Why would you do that? You know, especially people around me, you know, within the last 5 months, you know, they do the same thing. Why do you have this messiah-like Christ complex? I'm like, I don't. I'm just aligned with who I am. How is that having any form of messiah complex? I don't, you know. But the only way to be innovative as a society is when you question what has been, and, you know, The only way there's going to ever be change is when you're willing to push the boundaries of what is known.
Self-confidence and bravery is always misunderstood as arrogance by those who are weak-minded.
Exactly.
True arrogance is like getting in people's face like, I'm the shit, motherfucker. You bow before me, da-da-da. That's true arrogance. But when someone is just aligned with themselves and just doing good and saying, hey, this is what I've done, I could show you how to do it too if you want, but, you know, no pressure, whatever, I'm just on my chill flow, then people who are really insecure and easily butthurt perceive that as arrogance because they're so self-defeating and they're thinking like, well, I could never learn how to do that. This motherfucker's just rubbing it in my face. He knows I could never learn how to do that. He's just beating me over the head with the fact that we both already know that I'm too dumb to do that. And he's just so smart and he's rubbing it in and he's being a...
Well, you made your point. Yeah, you made your point. Yeah. I mean, it's, you know, it's, yeah. It's just, you know, you've got to be willing to leap off the cliff or, you know, whatever. You got to be willing to make the jump. You got to be willing to jump out of the airplane and, you know, hope that the chute deploys. I mean, that's pretty much what being an innovator is. I mean, you know, you got to be willing to be brave. You got to be willing to be bold. You got to be willing to go into new frontiers, you know, both psychologically and, you know, physically. You got to be willing to, you know, do what God made you to do. You got to be willing to explore. You got to be willing to investigate. You got to be willing to learn. You got to be willing to understand. Those are some of the primary core things that God put us on this planet to do, put us in this universe to do, along with many other sentient, intelligent life forms that I bet are out there right now, you know, exploring the stars and the heavens and the cosmos, you know. The only way to become innovative as a society is to be willing to push forward. I mean, I kind of look at it this way, you know. People back in the early 20th century said, you know, oh, if God wanted man to fly, would have given him wings. Well, leave it to a couple of bicycle builders in Ohio who came up with, you know, some of the early rudimentary basic controls for rudders. You know, I can tell you right now, I bet those two, for the longest time, were the laughing stock of their entire town. They were probably rich jackasses, probably going past their little tool shed, telling them that they're never going to do it. They're a bunch of failures. They should just give up right now. Man flying, ha ha, yeah, right. You guys are a bunch of crooks, you know. And lo and behold, in 1903, both Orville and Wilbur Wright become instant overnight celebrities because they figured out how to be heavier than air and fly. And nobody said that was possible. but they were willing to push the boundaries and make it possible because they were brave. They stood for who they were. They were a couple of craftsmen who didn't know much about avionics, but they were willing to test it out. They were willing to try it out. They were willing to research into it. And before you know it, the airplane was born, the modern airplane. And, you know, modern aviation as we know it became born. And then, of course, we reached another pinnacle in the 1940s. People said space travel was impossible. We were never going to go to the moon. And what happens 20 years later? Neil Armstrong steps on the lunar surface and says the famous words. That's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind. And the rest is history, you know. So people who say that warp travel isn't possible, people who say that, you know, developing engines that literally have no emissions and derive energy from basically nothingness is impossible. I just look at them and laugh and I go, well, if flying wasn't possible and early space travel wasn't possible, then, you know, and I say that with sarcasm. It's just like, well, if those things are possible, how is the next frontier, the next horizon not possible? You know, you're basing infinitesimal variables on things you don't even know nor comprehend or aren't willing to learn about, you know. And I think if humanity is willing to be bold and brave, I believe that we can do anything we put our minds to as a civilization, as a society. I believe we can have Star Trek in the next, you know, 30 or 100 years, depending on how rapidly we start expanding forward with technology. You know, 20 years ago, or, you know, maybe even 40 years ago, if you told somebody by 2014 we were going to have a cell phone that you could get on the internet with and you could talk to all your friends on Skype, they'd laugh at you. Or, you know, if they were the right person in the right position, they'd probably lock you up in a mental institution somewhere because they wouldn't believe you. Well, look at us now. You know, we've got, you know, Star Trek-like, you know, communicators in our hands, if you will, that have the capability of everything that one of those little communicators had, if not more so. You know, you can swipe a credit card from your phone now. You can, you know, buy something on eBay. You can sell something on Amazon, You can buy something on Amazon. You know, you can talk to your friends. You
Mr.
can
Spock.
Chat on Skype.
You Mr. Can... Spock, don't bother me right now. I am playing Angry Birds on my communicator.
Yeah, exactly. You know, and then Spock replies back, "Fascinating. I'm too busy trying to defeat Flappy Birds."
But why is the bird angry? I don't understand.
Anger is a illogical human emotion. I do not understand why the bird is angry.
Birds simply have survival instinct and only kill when they must. Birds do not get angry. That is illogical.
Exactly, you know.
Until you've met a parrot, those fuckers you can piss off. A pissed off parrot is like an evil freaking demon spawn from hell. Ugh.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah. I mean, you know, we've got so much abundance from just what we've learned with the space program and aeronautics and science and things of that nature. We have gained so much. You know, everything we talk on now, everything that we use came out of, you know, Soviet and American technology during the Cold War, you know, guidance systems and, you know, and British technology as well, the World Wide Web. I mean, you know, everything that we learned from the space program has been applied into modern life, you know, not even just Tang and, you know, Velcro straps, you know. We're talking computers, we're talking microcircuitry, we're talking, you know, the space program is what inspired those things to happen, what inspired that innovation, what inspired the idea of looking up into the heavens and saying, we can do something, we can go to the moon, we can do that, we can come back, we can, you know, say that we did that. You know, it's it's ideas that inspire people to do things and to go do something amazing that in turn is like a shockwave that inspires many others to do other things that are equally beneficial to humanity as a whole, you know. And society will not move forward, or society would have never moved forward had we had never embraced the idea of reaching out, of exploring, of understanding what fire was, of realizing there's more to the world than just inside a dark cave. You know, the willingness to look up and go, what's up there? What's over there? What's over there? You know, it's our basic fundamental nature to explore and to understand. And unfortunately, with our arrogance and our spoiled mentality, people have become bitter and have lost that spark, you know, for interest and curiosity. It gets drilled out of them in school. You know, teachers say, you know, oh, don't be curious. Just absorb and do what we tell you to do. Don't think for yourself. Don't be critical. Don't have intelligence. Don't have logic. Don't think critically. Just stay to the factory drone slate and just do exactly as we say when we say to do it. When we say jump, we want you to jump. You know, that's what people have been brainwashed into, you know. And fortunately, humanity is finally reversing and really quantumly jumping into the stars now. And, you know, we're headed somewhere good. It's just that we're going to deal with things like, you know, restraining orders and, you know, innocent people get felonies, people get beaten over the head by police, you know, people get shot by the police. You know, there's going to be crazy things that are going to happen. The next 30 years are going to be a rough and bumpy road. Things are going to happen that we didn't see coming. And, you know, good people and bad people alike are going to die, you know. You know, new people are going to be brought into this world who, you know, could be the future Einstein or the future Tesla. We're living in interesting times, but, you know, such is life. You know, life is getting more crazy and things are getting a little bit more, you know, intense. But, you know, overall, humanity's got a lot to look forward to. But anyway, with that being said, I need to go use the bathroom.
Well, with that being said, I think I will play one last of Ty's videos that actually has to do with exactly the sort of stuff that you were just talking about. That can be closed. A message to the rioters and police of Baltimore from Tai Lopez. And I think he's made some pretty good points in here. And seeing as Rich just left off, you know, talking about societal attitudes and, you know, the legal system and, you know, things that are more in alignment with this sort of thing, I think that it is very appropriate to pull this up, and here we go.
You know, when I think of all these riots breaking out across the United States, Baltimore, Oakland, I think the same thing that I think when someone asks me to comment on religion, politics, race. I think nobody's listening. What's the point? What's the point of having a conversation with somebody when nobody listening? Now, I'm not saying whether these riots are justified or not. That's not even my point. My mind goes to a higher place. A place of going, what do you do when people hold extreme ideologies? Charlie Munger says, avoid extreme ideologies. Try to look for disconfirming evidence. That means try to disprove yourself, right? Try to disprove your beliefs, those strongly held tenets that you hold to. And whenever you get into extreme situations, whether it be riots, protests, political debates, the same thing happens. People are just trying to pound away on whatever it is that they hold on to. The police in this situation, the rioters on this situation. But there's one fact That's basically irrefutable. When two parties do not listen, it's very easy for there to go, for it to become a race to the bottom. And you always want to avoid a race to the bottom. So the simplest solution, and one, of course, that will never happen, this would be a make-believe world, is one where the police sit down at a table and they have to argue the rioters' point of view better than the rioters can do that, better than the rioters can defend their actions. Charlie Munger said, I didn't allow myself to hold any belief with which I couldn't argue the other side better than the other side could argue their own point. And if the rioters sat down and took the other position, the second that happened in that imaginary world, or maybe not imaginary, you would see changes happening in the world almost overnight, because several things would kick in. One thing, the second you take someone else's point of view, you get some empathy. And humans make decisions. You know, my buddy who's a PhD was just here, if you saw that video. You know, we've got three parts to our brain. And everything starts in the reptilian mind, the old school, the old fashioned, if you will, the part of our mind, the brainstem, the cerebellum, where we make decisions emotionally. And so if there's no empathy, decisions get cut off before they even move to the higher parts of the brain, the higher parts of your brain, you know, your neocortex. And so what's happening in all these situations, it's the same thing that happens in political conversations when people are running from president. You know, I can't stand watching the debates for the same reason. It's not getting to the higher parts of the brain because it's blocked at the old part of the brain, the part of the brain that makes a snap emotional decision. So the second you and I lose the ability to take the other point of view, we lose the ability to use that natural part of our brain, that primitive part of our brain that gives us, believe it or not, insight, or at least the ability to find insight. Amygdala is a part of our brain, and it's a fear part of the brain. And the reason that in this riot, nobody's really listening to each other is because people are in a fear-based place. And once you're in a fear-based place, the amygdala takes over in your brain, and you can't think rationally. You can't think empathetically. You go into fight or flight, you're just worried about yourself. In this case, the rioters are worried about their side of the story, maybe rightfully so. And the police and the government, they're worried about their side of the story, not looking bad, not having to admit flaws and admit defeat. And so they also close off their brain. And so guess what we have? A race to the bottom. And you see times in history where people were able to break the race to the bottom. You see it with Martin Luther King Jr. You see it with Gandhi. You see it with Nelson Mandela. Where, what did they do? They created a forum where the brain, could operate, number one, the primal part of the brain, the lizard reptilian part of the brain, that controls that beginning gut feeling like, I don't like this person. They were able to get bypass that. And then they were able to bypass the amygdala. Martin Luther King Jr. used nonviolence so that people would start to listen for a second because they weren't in fear-based, literally going to war with each other. Now, I do believe throughout history, if you read, there's times where violent revolution was needed. I try to avoid the extreme saying always be nonviolent, but all or always be violent. But at some point, when you're facing somebody like the rioters are facing, you got to ask yourself, how do we solve the actual problem? Because one danger, and protesters around the world always face this danger, is that becoming or falling in love with the actual act of protesting and forget what the heck the point was at the beginning. The point is never to protest. The point is to be heard and to evoke a change in society. So, you know, if you look on Facebook, it's nothing but extreme ideologies. It's nothing but people not looking to try to prove the other side of the story. You know, if every person that can't stand these riots try to sit down for 10 minutes and honestly, because it takes honestly, write out a Facebook post of why the riots are happening. And on the flip side, if everybody that's rioting would sit down and write out, well, maybe there, this is the other side of the story. There's an ancient proverb that says, every argument sounds good till you hear the other side of the story. You see that if you ever watch, you know, court on TV, or you ever been in an argument where one friend tells you, hey, blah, 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 this is what, you know what Susie or Bob did to me? And you're angry, you're like, how dare Susie and Bob? But you break that golden rule of thought, which is you got to go to Susie and Bob and say, hey, can you tell me your side of the story? Or even better, you go to the accuser and you can say, and you say, if I go to Susie and Bob and I ask their side of the story, can you tell me honestly what they're going to say? Most people, of course, aren't honest enough, don't have a level of intellectual integrity to do that. But if they could, also the story sounds completely different. So, you know, you be different. I'm going to try to be different. What the world needs is people who think differently from the masses. My favorite, or one of my favorite poems, you know, for the mass of men lead lives of quiet desperation. What is called resignation is just confirmed desperation. And you see that in these riots, all kinds, both sides, confirmed resignation. Nobody thinking, you know, we need thought. We need sharp people. I tell people, don't be stupid.
Crash differently. Matt killed my inner child. How much of that did you get to watch? I don't know when you returned.
I think I watched like most of it. It was like only maybe a minute in when I got back.
All right. Do you have anything else to add to what he said?
No, just that, you know, that was another signpost that I thought was refreshing, was when the rioters and, you know, well, there were citizens in front of the police that, you know, blocked the protest, you know, that literally blocked the violent protesters and actually stood up for the cops and said, you know, hey, enough is enough. And just the cops' reactions were kind of priceless, because I don't think they were expecting that. And the next time that there is a globalist-generated conflict, officers all over the country are going to remember that scene and realize the people are not the enemy. You know, if anything, we need to reach out to people as much as possible, you know, because these are kind of untried, tested times, you know, just much like it was in 1775. The lines haven't really been drawn yet. And
I like how the guy was aware of the instigators, and he was keeping this big wide gap between the protesters and the police, so that the instigators, in order to do anything, would need to cross that gap. And as they attempted to cross that gap, he kept fighting back and pushing them back into the protesters and away from the police and saying, hey, you know, don't give the cops a reason. You know, these outside instigators come in, they're trying to start shit, you know, getting to give the cops a reason. Don't give the cops a reason. Keep your distance, keep your cool. You know, don't let this get out of hand. I thought that was really cool. Plus, like, you know, the mother going up to her kid, or kids like being a dick and throwing rocks and stuff, and she's just like, no! You know, it's kind of funny.
Mm-hmm.
I should do a
PSEC
with those videos in it one of these days, among other videos.
Well, yeah, we've got a big one that's coming up where we need to talk about the journal. And don't worry, folks, we will be doing a video on the Global Warming Journal that happened on DA between... Dave, fill me in. Cajun
and Valendale. I basically posted a journal entry that wasn't even about the topic of global warming, but just how people act in regards to the topic of global warming, and how neither side can, you know, neither side is open-minded to the other, and that both are dick-wagging. So neither side is listening, and both are like, wah, 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 wah. So then Valendale and Kajim, or however the hell you pronounce that, come in to kind of make my points for me. But I've been used to kind of like Vail and Dale being like, you know, of the two of them, the most closed-minded and whiny and unwielding, and Kejim being the most, you know, open-minded and willing to listen to reason. But as soon as I started saying that, you know, hey, you know, I think both of you are just acting like, you know, the bickering, you know, couple or something, you know, and that neither of you are really listening and so on and so forth. They just, like, basically both kind of ignored what I was saying and just kept trying to make their points against each other. But. And to my complete shock, Kejim is the one who went into complete and total butthurt meltdown and actually fucking blocked me. And Valendale actually started to calm down and become more and more reasonable with his replies, such to the extent that, you know, he made a lot of good points and asked a lot of good questions, and it was getting to be a lot to type going back and forth. So I'm just like, all right, we're going to hold off on this now, and eventually we're just going to address this whole freaking thing in a video, you know, full, you know, screen capture and verbal discussion and reading, you know, all the comments and stuff and addressing everything and just kind of doing a really thorough job with it. It's just that between work and college, Rich and I haven't really been able to align with that one. We're waiting for a huge block of time, because that's going to be one of those things that's going to be similar to the one we did, you know, PSEC 2015. Information is just information, to where that thing was like 5 hours of awesome hilarity. And none of us expected it to go that long, but it did. I don't even know how long this current hangout has gone, but I know at this point it should be 2 hours, give or take, because I know it was almost midnight or maybe even a little after midnight my time when we started, and it's like 20 minutes to two now, so we're hitting roughly the, you know, the 2 hour mark. But I think we're going to need more than that for the journal entry, the same as, you know, it took a lot more than that for information is disinformation. Because when it comes to, you know, reading and discussing, you know, comment threads, whether it's on Facebook or DeviantArt or whatever, like, that just takes a lot of time because it gets to be, you know, really expanded. So we will be doing that as soon as we can. We haven't been avoiding it or anything. It's just been all about the right fucking time.
Yeah, there's just going to be a lot that we'll have to go over, and the recent political situation with, you know, we can compare and contrast Ferguson with, you know, what happened in Baltimore, and we can just give more political spiels and examples and things of that nature, and just kind of, you know, go into the real details of what's been going on the last few months and silence and all that stuff. I don't know when that big one's going to happen because, you know, I've still got school and, you know, I won't be out until June 12th. So we might not even get to do it until next month, but, you know, no rush. I mean, there's no rush.
Yeah. But, you know, any interested parties wondering why we haven't done it yet. Oh, don't worry. We haven't forgotten. It's all been a matter of schedules. It hasn't been forgotten. It is very much periodically on our minds. So as soon as we can align for that, then we'll do it. Is there anything else you wanna add to this, or should we close out?
No, that's pretty much it, my friends. I mean, that's pretty much what's going on. You know, we're just kind of busy can be. You know, life's just kind of taking us on our motions and doing what life does, you know. And we shall talk again when the time is right and when things align, and, you know, I'll be back.
And because Tai Lopez is talking about thinking differently than society, and Mac's logo is think differently, and then I joked about crash differently, Mac killed my inner child, I think I'll close off with the now apparently 8-year-old video called Matt Killed My Inner Child, which is an oldie but a goodie. So I think I'll do that, because that's always a fun one to watch.
editing is all Mac based now. You know, the programs out there on the PC, but whether you're using Avid or using Final Cut Pro, you're working on a Macintosh. Using a Mac is a little different than using a PC. It's not so much operating a computer as it is sort of tricking it, fooling it into doing what it is you really want it to do. You kind of have to sneak up on it. I don't feel like I'm operating the Mac so much as I'm just there sharing the Mac experience. And if I can do something useful while the Mac is willing, so much the better. One of the coolest features of the Macintosh is it's really easy to shut down. All you have to do is be using a piece of software and then poof, it goes away. It's gone. It's shut down. You didn't push any buttons. You didn't close. You didn't even save. It's just gone. Unless you want to shut down a Mac. Oh, that's a whole other story. I mean, you try to close a program and it locks up. And then you do that funny, what is it, the cloverleaf period thing? These unnatural and ultimately useless interrupt keys. Then nothing moves. Then you push the power button and it won't turn off. You go around and unplug it. And you better hope you're not on a laptop, because then you got to find the damn battery and try to pull that out of the thing. It'll never shut down. So I put my CD in the CD-ROM tray, and I'm copying media off that CD, dragging it onto my desktop, dragging it onto my desktop, dragging it onto my desktop. I eject it, and where did my files go? It's the only operating system I know of where click and drag does not mean you actually copy or move anything. No, you're just making shortcuts on your desktop. So I've got my next CD, and I slam it into the CD-ROM tray, and lo and behold, it starts playing all by itself. I'm looking for a way to turn it off. Finally, out of desperation, I click and drag the CD into the garbage can. The system locks up. So I go to the cloverleaf period spacebar thing, hoping I can stop the program, and I get a little caution window saying, careful, interrupting this program may lock up the system. I try to click OK, but the system's already locked up!
I like the handle here. That's so you can attach a chain and use it as a boat anchor!
The Mac is practicing some kind of bizarre psychological warfare on me, because I'm working late at night, and at the corner of my eye, I keep seeing this thing jumping up and down. The update manager is bouncing at the bottom of the screen like a Jack Russell fucking terrier. So I'm looking around in the list of the files, trying to find the executable that wants me to update. And if I click on any one of them by accident, I rename it. Oh no, it's been renamed nothing. It was some kind of important system file, and the computer crashes. On a PC, no data is really lost. I mean, there's a way to undelete a file. If you know what you're doing in DOS, you can go in and recover anything that's been corrupted. On a Mac, if you lose a file, you run to the store, you get a copy of the Mac version of Norton Utilities, you run back only to have Norton go, you idiot, you own a Macintosh, the file is fucking gone, it's just gone. Don't have any tools or any kind of buttons or whatever dials or switches in the bottom of the screen, because if you reach for them, the dock menu comes up. Like angle around and slide and dodge the thing to get to the control. It's kind of like boxing with your computer. I can put it on the bottom, I can put it on the left, I can put it on the right. No, I can't put it on the top. That's reserved for the mighty blue apple. My name is Hunter Kressel. I'm an editor, and I cut together everything you saw tonight on a Macintosh. Mac killed my inner child.
Yep.
Yeah, that was great. Mac didn't end this hangout. I'm running Linux, but I'm going to end the hangout. We've been talking long enough, so thank you everybody for watching, listening, whatever. Hope you've enjoyed yourselves, and see you next time.
Have a good night.
You do it better.
Okay, let's do this properly. Good night, and may the force be with you.
Come, good food, come. Judge me by my size, do you?
Have a good night, everybody.